Hello. This video is brought to you by the Minnetonka Coalition for Equitable Education, or the MCEE. Today's discussion will focus on pedagogies and their incorporation into public school curriculum. Pedagogy? What does that word mean? Pedagogy is the method and practice of teaching, especially as an academic subject or theoretical concept. It refers to the study of teaching approaches and how they affect learners. The last part is the most important. Schools adopt pedagogies because of the benefits for students, whether it improves school climate, academic achievement, discipline disparities, or graduation rates. Pedagogies are adopted to help learners reach personal and communal fulfillment and optimal achievement. How many pedagogies are there? A lot. We are going to focus on a handful for today's video. To spice it up, we are going to reference each pedagogy with their founders and invite them all to a fun dinner party. So let's set the table and serve the food. The first person at our dinner table is multicultural education, or Sonia Nieto. Nieto thinks education needs to be built off the fundamental principle that learning can only be achieved through exposure. Children learn best when exposed to various cultures and identities. Nieto believes schools must move beyond tolerance, since tolerance itself has a connotation of vague indifference. Instead, differences are acknowledged and their importance is neither denied nor belittled. It's about respect, acceptance, affirmation, and critique. Nieto says it's not always rainbows and sunshines. Students will struggle, and there will be conflict, but it's better to discuss and confront conflict rather than avoid it. At the dinner table, Nieto is going to mention all the holidays this December, talking about Kwanzaa, Hanukkah, Bodhi Day, and Winter Solstice. Maybe even share her favorite NPR article on the globalization of religions. By the end of the night, she's passing out a pamphlet with her favorite films slash documentaries on Christianity, African cultural celebrations, Judaism, Islam, Sikhism, Hinduism, Buddhism, as well as many more. Now we move to Afrocentric education with Asante, Hilliard, and Akua. We included these thinkers because Afrocentric education spans decades, and each has added different layers to the pedagogy. So what is ACE? Afrocentrism centers the study of African people, knowledge, and nations through the lens of African cultural values. Some of these values include unity, self-determination, collective work, responsibility, purpose, and creativity. Akua celebrates the work of Gloria Lansley Billings with this truth. Black children are not white children painted black. Any instruction, classroom materials, or assignments should incorporate African cultural value systems to help address the psychological and cultural needs of African and African-American students. Hilliard would snap for Akua, telling the guests, African people have thousands of years of well-recorded deep thought and educational excellence. So let's talk about that. He would argue it's crucial for Black students to rediscover their ethnic identity in a lens that appreciates African cultural heritages. A curious observer, you may turn to the ACE thinkers and ask why they want to get rid of Eurocentrism and white perspectives so bad. Asante laughs when people believe Afrocentrism discourages Eurocentrism or is trying to rewrite history. He laughs because if you read his book, The Afrocentric Idea, he finds Afrocentrism working alongside Eurocentrism. He believes you need both to understand history. One of the major tenets of ACE is respecting and making space for differing perspectives. Asante is also one of the lead scholars on Afrocentrism, meaning he's kind of old, so he may be asleep before dessert. Now we move on to culturally responsive teaching, or culturally relevant pedagogy, with Gloria Lansley Billings. Gloria thinks the most important part of teaching is creating a supportive environment for students. CRT focuses on the skills of teachers. Skills like empathy, self-reflection, knowledge about various cultures, and collaboration. When Gloria takes her seat, she's going to high-five Akua because they both believe in creating a supportive environment by answering the culture needs of the students. She would even ask everyone to do a racial autobiography before the appetizers are ready. CRT is solely on improving teachers' abilities to teach every student they encounter. It means teachers can understand how a student who is neurodiverse may struggle with spontaneity in classroom activity. They may struggle with inhibition or regulation. Instead of punishing the student, the teacher would work with the student and family to best understand how to support the child. Next, we move on to Kevin Cushimiro, who represents the anti-oppressive pedagogy. Kevin was that kid in class who questioned the teacher all the time. Why? Because disruption is key. Anti-oppressive pedagogy implores educators to examine the necessary changes needed to reduce othering and promote consciousness building in public schools. Kevin sees education as having a formal curriculum and hidden curriculum. The hidden curriculum represents hidden values that are not explicitly taught, which devalue people or identities. Kevin would encourage teachers to discuss not just the Voting Rights Act of the 1960s, but also the history of voting ID laws and their threat to voting rights in modern-day settings. To this pedagogy dinner, Kevin brought a hammer and hot glue. What can he say? He loves breaking things down and constructing new institutions for everyone. Our last guest is Paulo Freire, who represents critical humanism. Freire is a humanist, and his pedagogy is mixing a humanistic approach to education with a critical analysis of the broad social, political, and economical context. He would explain his banking education woes. Current students or learners are not actively participating in their learning, in problem solving, or interacting. Instead, current students are expected to receive, memorize, and repeat information. Students are being deposited information like a bank account when students should have a reciprocal relationship with teachers and their curriculum. Freire emphasized the collaborative, social nature of learning and the elimination of the power dynamic between teacher and student. He wants students to develop critical literacy and learn about inequalities or injustice, just like Kevin and Nieto talk about. Lastly, he focuses on the creative passion and curiosity within students. These are the factors which lead students to become successful learners. At the end of the dinner, right before dessert, you ask each dinner guest to explain what they all have in common, since everybody sounds so different. An outsider looking in may think all of these dinner guests fight constantly about who is more right. They all laugh. Each guest explains their pedagogies have the same principle. Students need to develop a critical consciousness which empowers them to question, inquire, and dive deeper into school subjects to understand truth, culture, and justice. So how does this apply to Minnetonka public schools? Well, schools can apply all of these pedagogies in some shape or form to develop a comprehensive curriculum and school climate. Let's take a play out of the Tuscan Unified School District. They have a basic format of multicultural education that follows just like below. In elementary school, they begin to introduce concepts of various cultures and identities. They explain basic definitions and characteristics. In middle school, teachers implore content which builds off cultures and identities to the concept of justice. How are different groups being treated, and what is their perspective on life? In high school, teachers move forward with action. At this point, students learn about civil engagement, public policies, and further in-depth knowledge about all the cultures which exist within America and beyond. Thanks for watching our video. As always, be sure to follow us on our social media.